Department of Communication and Media Enterprise, Pan Atlantic University, Issa Momo. Also joining us via Skype is a researcher of the Department of Politics, University of Sussex, United Kingdom, Uche Igwe. Good morning to you, gentlemen.
Good morning.
It's good morning to have you right here in the studio. Now, let's even begin by talking about exactly who is entitled to this diplomatic passports, who should be in, you know, possession rightfully in possession of it, and who has no business having it.
I think that all that represent Nigeria internationally should be entitled to diplomatic passports. That those that go out to do duties for the country should have it. And as an explanation of such duties, they should return the passports. Most people keep it because they expect other future duties. And it will be a hassle going forth, back and forth to collect it. So that's why they keep it. So I thought that if somebody already has the passport, and you think he no longer will carry out duties for Nigeria internationally, you should inform him, you should go there and collect it. Not order him to return it. Nigerian government or civil servants are used to diktat. You want to pay your tax, you go to them to pay your tax. You want to collect receipt, you go to them to collect receipt. This thing is service, it's called service. They should come to us. We are more in number than them.
Okay, we have Uche Igwe on the phone, but before that, let's hear what Babatunde says about the arrest of officers who have refused to return their diplomatic passports.
In view of the earlier publication on returns of official diplomatic passports by former politicians, political correspondents, and retired public servants, we made a publication early this year that all retired public servants, all former political office holders must return their diplomatic and official passport. Now it is time to act.
Okay, you just heard what Babatunde said. Uche Uge, Igwe, many thanks for joining us on TVC Breakfast this morning. What is your reaction to this new decree, really, as it is, that if you don't return your diplomatic passport, you will be arrested? What's your reaction to that?
Well, I think that those who are still in possession of diplomatic passports after their diplomatic positions, as it were, have expired, should return them. But I do not think also they should be arrested. There could be several reasons why the passports have not been returned. And this is a democracy. So I think that the right thing to do is to ask them to return the passports rather than to threaten to... arrest them. So that's my position.
Okay. All right, let's shed more light on this. Traditionally, a diplomatic passport is an official document issued to professional diplomats and ambassadors by their home governments to facilitate their work in a foreign country. Now, let's look at how important this document is.
The issuance of the document is guided by rules under the 1815 Congress of Vienna that formalized the exchange of diplomatic agents among nations. These rules are stringent and restricts the issuance of the document only to professional diplomats who are representatives of their heads of government.
Now, those issued the document are assumed to be people of impeachable character and integrity. Same for holders of the official passport issued to individuals on official assignments for a sovereign nation. Unfortunately, in Nigeria, these vital documents aren't used for what they're meant for. Over the years, there has been a proliferation of diplomatic and official passports such that all manner of persons who are by no means entitled carry them and subject them to wanton abuse.
What was seen as a privilege extended temporarily to diplomatic staff who were obliged to promptly return the documents on leaving service became a bonanza enjoyed illegally by all and sundry, including politicians, businessmen and women, clerics, traditional rulers and even mistresses.
Okay. The unwieldy number of diplomatic and official passport holders has exposed Nigeria to some dangers because some of these people who have no business carrying either document can use them to engage in criminal activities capable of denting the country's image abroad. And so the question that I should throw to you, Issa Momo, why is it, or why was it that in the past, anybody, including mistresses, I mean, that almost makes you want to laugh, but this is really not a funny matter, considering, you know, the uses that these people can actually put it to. Why was it so easy for anybody to get these diplomatic passports?
Let me react first to the denigration of women in our society. Mistresses are not just including. They also perform official functions for the country.
Mistresses?
Spies, most spies.
Spouse, you mean?
No, spies, not spouse.
Oh, spies.
Most spies.
And mistresses?
Yes, are supposed to perform the duties of their gender in representation of their country. So let's not say why should they have
but
it.
But would that That's be what in I'm an saying. Official so capacity spies, or yes, just yes, because, official, you know?
Yes, you watch James Bond films, you watch others, where you see a female agent, security agent, go to perform, including going to bury an enemy. And she does not withhold herself. In that moment, she's called a mistress. So let's not denigrate them. Because this from this little attitude, our discipline against women steps up.
That's interesting. But, it's good that you clarified
but
that.
But one, I think that it is not just for diplomats. No passports are not just for diplomats. No passports are meant to extend diplomatic privileges to those carrying them, i.e. those who are doing something specifically required by the country at that moment. So I agree, it's a temporary privilege given to anybody. And when it is given, in Nigeria, unfortunately, it's not given to you with the caution that this is temporary, this is a privilege, please, as soon as you out of office, bring it. But we also know people leave offices. That's why I said, let the government do its duty of collecting its documents. As you are leaving office, sir, this is your privilege, this is your benefits. These are my documents. You give me my documents, I give you your benefits. It becomes very simple. But you allow them to go away and so on, then later you are harassing them on television and so on, without the proof that you went to them and they refuse to give you. I agree, I mean, those views notwithstanding, I say anybody that breaks the law should be punished.
Okay. Mr. Igwe here, who do we blame where you have people who are not meant to have the passports, in possession of such passports? Who is it, the officers or the public officers themselves? Who do you blame?
Well, I blame both parties. It is the duty of government to retrieve these passports. And, you know, when an era ends, there's a likelihood that these public officers take other assignments or, you know, retire to private life. So the government has got the network and the power to summon them and retrieve these diplomatic passports, as it were, without necessarily dramatizing them by threatening arrest and all of that. The assumption, as the earlier speaker said, is that these persons are persons who are respected and who have unimpeachable integrity, and it is natural for them to be willing to return these passports as soon as they are called upon. Another way to do it is to, as the last speaker said, tie them to some specific benefits. For instance, there are severance allowances and all kinds of things paid to public officers, you know, at the expiration of their tenure of office. So, you know, there's a way to tie some of those benefits to, you know, these passports and some other things in their possession. So government has got the power and the network to retrieve some of the diplomatic passports without making a whole lot of issues out of them.
Okay, I would like your reaction on the issue of mistresses in possession of diplomatic passport. Our guest here says, of course, I watch a James Bond movie, so I understand that, but I probably just thought that's just in the movies. Do you support that?
Well, I do not think that, you know, I will be cautious in saying that they will be used to commit crimes or all kinds of things, except that stolen, as it were. So I don't think that persons who have grown up to the point that they will serve as diplomats, you know, will be people who would want to use their positions to commit crimes. Of course, there are deviations, and those deviations and exceptions will be dealt with accordingly. So, but to generalize that the reason for these passports being kept behind is that they may be used for to commit crimes is something that I wouldn't want to align with.
Mr. Momo, the fact that, you know, like you mentioned earlier, that maybe government should tie some kind of incentives, you know, to this, to encourage these diplomats or officials to actually return their passports. Is it not a sign of a failure of a system that has, you know, not been able to give confidence to public officers that at the end of their service, whether, you know, yes, that there's actually something to look forward to, and so they want to use the opportunity of something like a diplomatic passport to get whatever they really should be getting from system naturally?
From my experience and in the best of my knowledge, those people are not keeping the passports to commit crimes.
Most people not necessarily to commit a crime, but to misuse their entitlement.
Yes, most people who are entitled to diplomatic passports are people of high responsibility and great integrity. The facilities in our country make it difficult for you to have moved out of office in circumstances of government failures. Most of the time, the people are retired, you know, without notice. When they are retired, they are not paid their benefits, and government demands its own requirements. So all this mark of government failure, like you asked, who is responsible? The government is likely responsible. Who issues out this passport? It's the government, isn't it? So there should be a register for them. And as it's not there, I mean, once they are not there, they should be content to return it. Two, if they are going to misuse the passport, they will have to use departure points, isn't it? Who are the people at the departure points seeing the passport? Immigration officials, they are called border police. At that point, can they say, sorry, sir, you're not entitled to this passport, and so we can't let you go. We take the passport.
So, but how do you explain, you know, a suspected Palestinian terrorist who was in possession of Nigeria's diplomatic passport last year?
Yes. That led I think government has no hand in it. If you read the bundling of Moridico from UK, we contacted people in Palestine, in Israel. We gave them our passports to act on behalf of us, Nigerians. The people who carried him into the plane had Nigerian passports. The Israeli passport was not with them. So government is one big business that you don't know how they operate. It could do anything, like those you talked about. That's why I really took on that. If we take that angle, we can abuse women so much. You know, an ex-female diplomat is called to go and do something for government somewhere. Even as little as match fixing. You know, fixed football matches? People are called to go and fix matches and say, look, don't so that nobody harasses them, they give a diplomatic passport. To go and negotiate with referees and so on, to put their eyes on the other side when infringes are committed so that we can win.
Wow.
When those people are caught, government denies them.
Because Paradin was sacked because of that. Mr. Paradin was sacked because of this Palestinian in possession of
a
diplomatic passport.
But I'm thinking that he could not have done it on his own. He would have had instruction from somewhere. Just that when it comes to public glare, the authority disowns you. That's what I'm talking about, failure of government.
Some diplomacy there.
Well, let's continue and look at other perspective to the story. In the not-too-distant past, there were instances where some state governors, holders of the diplomatic passports, were arrested abroad for conduct incompatible with holders of such documents. A minister was at one time delayed at an airport in the U.S. for carrying $250,000 cash. He had a diplomatic passport, a symbol of integrity and honor.
There are many former officials with the red and blue passports which have not yet expired, like former state governors and ministers who deliberately refused to submit the documents after serving their terms and are now abroad using them illegally.
Now, apart from those who have left public service but are still holding on to their diplomatic and official passports, there are also those who have been redeployed to departments where they no longer need the documents and can use them to commit crimes capable of bringing the nation to disrepute. Hence, the urgent need to recover the passports.
Unfortunately, the first abusers of the passports are the issuing authority, thus the Immigration Service itself and, of course, its officers who indiscriminately issue the documents to all manner of people, including top government officials and politicians in elective or appointive offices, who are neither no diplomatic nor official assignment. They are not on diplomatic official or any official assignment, and yet
they have access to this passport. Now, so let me go to Uche Igwe. It is obvious that these kinds of things cannot happen without the collusion of immigration officials themselves. Okay, unfortunately, we've lost contact with Uche. We'll try to reconnect. So, yes, there's collusion. There's collusion, you know, from within the immigration themselves. So isn't that where the house cleaning should start?
That's where, and that's why if you listen to Babadende's speech, he warned his officers that he's tired of the ills in the service. He was going to have meetings this week with controllers and so on, and the zonal people to curb that. So what should have done was to appeal to these people who have the diplomatic passport to return them because they are no longer in that position. But I even quarrel with that. Because to me, a man of integrity is always a man of integrity. When you call somebody His Excellency, when his office, leaving office does not remove his being excellent. Because excellence just means behaving excellently. So you expect him to behave excellently. It's like the military, at the rank of general from brigadier and above, when you are retired on the reserve. So, are you going to return your pistol, return your caps, and so on because you are no longer serving? You are given a number of years to keep those things. So, when you are called up, you don't have to go for the kitty in and so on. So, I think that these passports given to honorable men should be left with them until they expire. When those passports expire, then they call for renewal. Then you are asked, what do you think you are still going to do for Nigeria diplomatically to make you deserve
those,
this?
So those whose passports are still functional, you're saying they should still keep them.
But as for those who use them for crime, of course they should be punished, as I said. Because a passport or even your Bible or your this does not make you guarantee that you will not sin. Right? But if you sin, you must ask God for forgiveness or ask the nation, you know, to pardon you. But first, I think if you, no matter how certified you have to be of integrity, and you misbehave, you should be called to answer for it. So those caught abroad and anywhere, even at our borders, should be questioned, dealt with according to the law. And I'm not sure that the law contains threats.
Now, when the new Controller General of Immigration, Babandede himself, says that these people should be arrested at points of entry like the airports or the borders and all of that, the question then is, how do you differentiate between who really is legally in possession of this diplomatic passport, so you don't end up embarrassing government officials?
It is better to embarrass them at that point than let them embarrass the nation abroad. So normally, when you travel as ordinary citizens, your passport is held by the immigration officer, and he asks you some simple, often stupid questions. For example, what's your name? He's looking at your passport. He sees your name, then he asks you to be sure that you are the owner of the passport. Sir, this passport was issued 5 years ago. It should have expired, right? So, what were you when you got it? What are you now? 5 minutes, that thing is sorted out. And then it's determining whether you...
I like to agree with you, but you know how cultured some of this police officers can be, really. So what happens to somebody who was in government 5 years ago and still in government today?
Good. So he tells you, I'm still in government. I'm entitled to it. For example, a party chairman who, for one reason or the other, was given diplomatic passport because he goes for diplomatic meetings with other parties in other countries. When he has left, he may be a BOT person. You get it? He may have risen beyond chairmanship. He may be one of those that will be called on to go and do negotiations and so on. So he has to explain to you. We all owe explanation to each other. The problem is that we under-communicate and we communicate rudely. What if somebody approaches politely, sir, why do you think you're still entitled to this passport? You will not get angry. You not flare up, my friend, you're wasting my time. That's what we fear. That's the embarrassment we think. But officers are meant to be firm and gentlemen, whether in the police, in the military, anywhere.
Indeed. Okay, so let's bring you some more perspectives to what we're talking about this morning. Now, some embassies treat Nigeria's red and blue passports with the same disdain they treat the green general passport. Now, who are those qualified to carry diplomatic passports? Well, I think our guest has tried to explain that for us earlier. Now, visiting heads of states and their families, top officials of government and their families, diplomats and their families, holders of United Nations diplomatic passport, members of accredited diplomatic missions, members of international organizations, and so on and so forth.
Yes, and of course, accredited international non-governmental organizations, of course, are also entitled to carry the passport. What then are the requirements for the issuance of diplomatic passports? Letter of introduction from applicant's ministry, parastatals, or extra-ministerial department, duly signed by an officer no below the rank of a director or secretary to state government in case of an employee of state government. Police report is also required, and of course, court affidavit in case of lost passport. Don't forget one passport, paragraph, a photograph, acknowledgement slip, and receipt of payment. So,
okay, there you go. For all those questions, that should really clarify, give clear answers to people who might be curious out there. Now, let's look at some of the other innovations that the new Controller General has come up with, decentralizing, the passport offices and all of that. What do you think about that? And how is that going to help?
I think he's starting well. He's starting well. He sent the message clearly across that I belong to this government of least corruption. I don't want to say no corruption, because you can't wipe out corruption unless you wipe out all the human beings. For example, people that they may have referred to as mistresses may be female members of diplomats' families. It's not all the time that they are coming by their husbands traveling. And so I will not give room to any immigration officer internationally to abuse a Nigerian diplomat's wife because the husband is not there. Or a diplomat's daughter. Or a diplomat's even house girl, because they are entitled to go with their house helps. So if you allow them to employ foreigners in their house, of course, all the secrets are then out in the public. So they need to go with their house girls. Nobody would go out with the house girls or these females and say, I must regulate your conduct. I must regiment your conduct. Yeah, you can regulate, but not regiment them. Then you cut them in second and you say, oh, they are mistresses. I really, really hate them because I respect my wife a lot. I respect my mother very much.
That's good to know.
You get it? So yes. I don't think anybody should, under any excuse, insult them.
Okay, so how would this decentralization help fast-track the workings of the immigration service?
In fact, should not just decentralize, he should fix a deadline for getting back your passports or your applications as soon as you put it. For example, in the ports, we say, well, your goods must be declared within 48 hours. So there should be such a rule that within 48 hours, application for passports must either be honored or refused. You know, so the officers will know, and then clearly the guidelines. Because some of these passports issued to those not entitled to are also done by the immigration office officials. They go to put in members of their family when they are issuing the abuse of power. So you should tell them no abuse of power, and these are the punishments for it. And lastly, there should be a public complaints line for people who are ill-treated by immigration officials at whatever point, either at border points or at the issuance or passport offices, to make complaint. And so should reach Babangida himself directly, or his director of public affairs, so that these things can be attended to and the public will be well served. Because as I said, civil service is meant to be service to the civilian population, given civilly, i.e. in a civilized way.
Indeed. And of course, he's talked about setting up an anti-corruption squad within the immigration. This obviously is part of the house cleaning that Babangida is bringing on board. How do you think
it must work? The police has an anti-corruption squad also, don't they?
So what will make it work?
The body language of the man at the top. His commitment to making it work, no exemptions. So strict compliance with the guidelines and his dictates that he wants, even when others come from on top. Because politicians are used to say, oh, it's order from above, I can't disobey. You can disobey. You can live without a job. How many Nigerians are employed? How many Nigerians are still living? So if you have the courage to say no to a bad order, the worst that can happen to you is that you, you are pushed out.
But and you have the right to complain. The system does not protect such people who are willing to say no to the system.
The system,
you know,
in future will protect. System? That's what Buhari is showing.
Before that, then, what happens to those who want to stand out and be forthright?
That's what I'm saying. Those who are forthright would have their way. Because if you are not tainted and you say no to a tainted person, he gets afraid. Yes, he goes to abuse his power to deal with you surreptitiously.
If you ever been to the Abuja office where you get those passports out, the queue's there, and just while you're there waiting to be served, someone comes from somewhere and leaves you people on the queue, and is he or she's attended to because he's got a lighter from some senators. And he's got a lighter.
In addition to that, Busolami, the issue of, you know, a case where you actually you lose your passport, the e-passport, for example, you have to go all the way to Abuja to get replacement.
Decentralization is about.
That's what he's addressing now. That you don't have to come to Abuja.
Yes.
It's a federation, for God's sake. It's not an authoritarian or unitarian government where everything is centralized. And that's what we're saying. Still restructure this country so that there'll be more looseness, more freedom, things done at the village level, at the least level of the government, local government. I'm one of those who advocate town councils. You know, so that Lagos was many governments, not only local governments.
Maybe to issue passports.
No, to do everything that government is supposed to do.
Oh, okay.
Just that government has a set of rules, guidelines, and so on that we followed by every office. So, and that's why people disdain our passport because they know that with the corruption, they cannot say which passport was genuinely given and which was not given. But I must also appeal to Nigerians on such cues as you described to be patient, because those going on urgent duties must breach the queue, right? To be so we should understand it. But when it is
how would we know that this is
urgent?
That's what I say, be patient.
That's what I say, be patient. You will not know. So assume that they deserve it. It's when it's getting so much that you then protest. If once, twice, you then protest. I've been here for this. I'm entitled to this because I'm a Nigerian like that other Nigerian. Just that he's going for official duty, so I concede, but attend to me. And for government officials, they should create a queue or a line to attend to such people. It happens in the private sector also. At the peak point of banking, that's when you find that they are shutting the shelves. You get it?
Yes.
Whereas when the customers are many, you create a new shelf. So that's what I'm advocating for government.
Now, looking at some of the new measures that Babangida is bringing on board with immigration, do you think he should be revisiting the immigration tragedy that happened in 2014, the recruitment exercise that led to the loss of lives? What do you think he should be addressing as far as that is concerned?
Well, I'm sure there will be no resort to that kind of thing anymore. And I think the case is still in court. I think Abba Moro was arrested and detained and that kind of thing. But that was flagrant abuse of procedures and all for selfish greed to make money. Otherwise, why would you ask applicants who have no job to come and pay money?
1,000 naira.
And you, for a job that you think you need only 500 people or 5,000 people, you get 50,000 people. It means you just wanted to make money. And so with whoever was involved should be punished and steps should be taken so that there's no repeat of that kind of thing again.
Okay.
Oh yes, that was a disaster. I always lament the loss of even one life anywhere, because it could be anybody.
So let's look at the issue of training for the officers. Quite a number of issues around lack of finesse sometimes in the way they deal with people. Don't you think Babangida should also look at that aspect of, apart from just issue of culture, issue of finesse, issue of psychological training that will help? Because when you've been waiting in line for days and you've not been attended to, you need an officer who is calm and who understands the pressure you've been on.
Yes, that is true. Not just training, I think there should be a total quality control retooling of not just the immigration, but all public service points, including private sector public service points. Because when I go to my bank, I expect that I'm treated with courtesy. But what happens now, most of the training that we give to our staff are technical training. We don't look at this civil, means civilization training. And being civil means being patient, being tolerant, even when you are abused by customers. So, they should be given quality training in terms of character, in terms of customer service, in terms of courtesies, in terms of etiquette, not just ethics. If you, and this training should be repeated. It shouldn't be done, you've gone once, and so throughout your career, that's all you have. It should be said that at every point, maybe two years, so there should be a huge budget for training, because that's really what enters the human being. Indeed. And that's what comes out of the human being.
Indeed.
The quality you put in him or her is what comes out. I used to tell them in Unilag, as if a student goes to a department where there's good teaching, but the toilet is unkept. In his home, he'll keep the toilet unkept. If there are cobwebs in the classroom, he will allow cobwebs in his home. So we all live by the standards to which we are trained. Not just trained ones, but repeatedly trained and exposed to. Then there should be manuals of conduct and not just of operation. Because in most organizations, including immigration, we have manuals of operation. You know, and when you can use your passport, where you can do this. But what of manuals of conduct?
Indeed, and that would of course include, you know, looking at a situation where officials actually collect, you know, bribes
for
just to get, you know, the Nigerian passport. That in itself is a bad, you know, place to start.
Not just bad, it's terrible, because that's where all the gaps open. If I can corruptly get my passport, then I feel entitled to use it corruptly, isn't it? But if I'm denied it because I'm not entitled to it, then I even don't have the chance to abuse it.
Indeed.
But do you think that Nigerian paramilitary officers are well remunerated? Remember the issue of customs. The DG of the boss of customs actually made a case for the officers, saying that if you want corruption to be reduced, then you have to upgrade their standard of living. Because if they are hungry when they collect money, they will make do and help themselves to some of it.
I've always advocated for government to be run as a business. Even if it's a not-for-profit business, at least generate the money you require, and then you can spend it on yourself. Of course, with somebody approving and so on, according to guidelines and so on. So, yes, military officers should be remunerated properly. Take the worst case, the policeman that stands on the road for 12 hours, standing, holding a gun, instruments of oppression and so on, and he's standing, the rain is beating, the sun is beating, nobody cares for him. If he has provision for lunch, the officers in the office will eat it. Provision for uniform, they are not given. Provision for boots, they are not given. You know the case of those we sent to West African fights, the soldiers, whose allowances were corruptly taken, and when they got back, they were court-martialed and so on. It took the public to cry out before they were saved.
Indeed.
Remember the Boko Haram people too, the soldiers were going to fight Boko Haram, without their rations and so on, and they refused to go. And the commander put them under a guard room, and before they were tried, and they're going to lose their life. Unfortunately, they've been converted to other kind of things. So this corruption, that's why I said the Buhari government is right in saying there are two challenges. The security challenge, which Boko Haram was the apex of, and the corruption challenge.
And those challenges are what he's, you know, doing everything to tackle right now.
But we're saying, please also tackle electricity, because that is one of our first. And like you talk to the Commissioner for Works, roads are important, so the bridge is very important.
Indeed.
But electricity is the greatest facilitator of crimes, abuse, and corruption.
And that's where we'll have to leave it. Issa Momo, a university lecturer, it's been nice talking with you on this issue this morning.